so excited for this year's VBS. If you haven't stopped by in our lobby, we do have a table that you can register your kids today. We do have an early bird special, so every child is $25. And if you want to volunteer, you can get a discount, and it is only $15 for your child. Last year, we had an amazing time with over 200 kids, and we are so excited for this year's VBS. It is July 18th through the 21st at 9 a.m. to noon. So make sure you sign up your kids today. We're trying to push everybody to pre-register. This will help make everything so much easier, and our team is so excited to host your children. If you know of anybody in the community, your neighbors, maybe your grandkids, make sure to tell them to come to this year's VBS. It is all about sparking their imagination. God has created each and every one of them with a purpose, and we want to steward that and make sure they know that they are designed by God, that they don't have to be wandering this world and trying to figure out who made them. God made them. So I want them to really know that they have a purpose and God is going to use them powerfully. So make sure to sign up for this year's VBS. Again, it is July 18th through the 21st at 9 a.m. to noon. So register today. Don't be the last people to sign up. Sign up today. Prices will increase after June 5th. So make sure to sign up today in our lobby.
Hey, thank you, Pastor Ray Adriana. I'm so excited for VBS. One last thing we want to mention is that CLC is going to a Mariners game on June 16th. Mark that in your calendars. You can purchase the tickets from Pastor William by emailing him at williamy@clcpo.org or connecting with him in person in the lobby before or after service. And so with that being said, let's join the room as we head into service.
Well, good morning, church. How's everyone doing this morning? Come on, let's stand our feet. Those of you joining us online, thanks for making CLC a part of your weekend. But today we're going to declare God's goodness in this place, that he's a God that's still in the miracle-working business, a God that fights for us. So let's just believe that God's going to do mighty things. Amen? Come on, let's sing this together. Let's put our hands together. Come on. The name above the battle, Savior stands with me. The fight of all the weary, the Lamb of God, the Lion Hearted King. The glory of the Father. Seen the power of the undefeated. feet, a Savior stands with me. The fighter for the weary. Sing the Lamb. The Lamb of God, the Lion Heart, He came over every broken heart. See, hope is arising through the dark, over every weary soul, and over every weary soul. Breathe miracles, and heaven come and hell retreat. The signs and wonders be released. The King of the impossible. We can see your kingdom come. We believe the war is won. Right here, your will be done. Come awaken us, Jesus. Come awaken us. We can see your kingdom.
Good morning. My name is Seth, and we are so thankful that you joined us today. Welcome to church. Those of you with us in person today, you received a program as you came in. Inside, you'll find a connection card. During service, please take a moment to fill out as much information as you feel comfortable with, then drop those cards in the buckets during the offering. For those of you guys watching online, simply click the link to our connection card in the comments of this live stream. If you're wanting to connect even faster, we have made it easy to connect here at CLC. Text CONNECT to 9366 and you can connect quick and easy. We also want you to know that by filling out a connection card, the staff at CLC prays over each and every single one that comes in. We're here for you, CLC. We want to encourage you and walk alongside you throughout your week. So be sure to let us know of anything you need prayer for today. With that being said, let's jump right back into worship.
God, we just thank you for this morning. We thank you that you're a God that fights our battles, a God that gives us victory over anything and everything. Come on, church, let's declare this out. Let's sing this together. Come on.
And all I see is the battle. You see my victory. Belongs to you.
Jesus, then nothing can stand against the power. Come on, declare this out, church. In all my
seated this morning. If you're newer to CLC, it's a really one of my favorite Sundays where we get to do communion together. And if you follow Jesus, you're a follower of Christ, you're more than welcome to do communion with us this morning. In the seat right in front of you, there's a little holder and there's communion elements. Go ahead and grab those and start opening them now. And we're going to do communion together as a family of God. I find it interesting that Paul writes to the church that he started in Corinth. I don't know if you know this, but Paul was a church planter. He planted many churches. And he's writing back to the church he planted in Corinth, and he gives them instructions that we follow to this day with communion. And he said that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, that's the Thursday before Easter, Maundy Thursday, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The beauty of that moment is this. Jesus took the bread, he broke the bread, he blessed the bread, and then he served the bread to everyone around that dinner table, which is an illustration of what God often does to you and I. We come to Jesus and we say, "Jesus, forgive me of my sins. God, I want to go to heaven and be with you for eternity." He'll take your life and he'll break things off of your life that hinder you, that trip you up, that cause you to sin. He'll take you, he'll break you, he'll bless you, and he'll use you. It's exactly what he did with the bread at communion on Maundy Thursday. He took it, he broke it, he blessed it, he used it. For some of you, you need to remember that you might be in one of those four stages. God may have just taken your life and saved you. God may be breaking some things off of you. God may be blessing you, or God may be using you. Communion reminds us of the depth of God's love. How wide, how high, how deep, how wide, how high, how deep, how wide, how high, how deep is the love of God for me? We will search for that for the rest of our life. So communion is that beautiful. He loves you. So would you hold that bread in your hand and let's pray. Heavenly Father, we hold in our hand the symbol that represents the body of Christ, which was beaten and bruised and ultimately killed and sacrificed on our behalf. Father, I pray for everyone in this room who may be in one of those four stages of being taken, broken, blessed, or used, that Father, you would remind us that you have us in your hand. You understand, you're with us, you're near, you're by us, you're in us. Father, I pray today we would remember the presence of God, that you promised you would never leave us, you would never forsake us, you would never give us so much that we can't handle. And Father, I pray today that communion would remind us of our communion with you. So God, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take the bread together. Paul continues to write in Corinthians, and this is another beautiful part of the story. Then it says, after supper. So after supper, which means it took a while. In church, I'm 39 seconds over communion, my spot. I don't care. Communion took all dinner. It took from beginning to end. After supper, Paul said, Jesus took the cup. And he said to the disciples, he says to you, this is my new covenant with you. Do this in remembrance of me. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he returns. It's a brand new covenant with you. What's that covenant? Jesus, by dying and bleeding, by his stripes, you are forgiven, you are healed. All the mistakes and sin you've committed, Jesus cancels out. And if you have Jesus in your heart, you stand before God guiltless and perfect. The way the song says it is this way. Jesus paid, how much of it? Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe, which means every day we proclaim the love of Jesus because of what he did for us. That's the symbol of the cup. Brand new covenant, brand new deal between you and God. So would you hold that cup and let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your selflessness in that, God, you, while we were yet sinners, died for us. That, Father, you took all of the sin and the shame of the world to the cross and nailed it to the cross so that we might be forgiven, we might be made right. Lord, we thank you that Jesus did pay it all, and all to him I owe. Thank you for this moment. May communion never be just a ritual, but may it be a reminder in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's take the cup together. And this morning we're going to do something different, so you don't have to stand up. What I want you to do is I want you to contemplate the words of this next song. And I want you to own the words. And I want these words to go deep into your heart. God bless you.
Change the leper's spots.
Came to church this morning. Those of you joining online, again, thanks for joining us. But we're going to teach you guys a new one this morning. I love how the Bible says to sing to God a new song. Like, I love when I get to hear the church sing loud and lift up the name of Jesus, where we can back off and hear you guys. But today, this next song is called The Same God. And it really comes from Hebrews 13:8, where it says that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So let's stand to our feet, let's get into worship. But I love how in Malachi 3:6 it says, where God says, "For I, the Lord, do not ever change." How many are thankful that we serve a God that doesn't change? Amen. That He sees us in all our iniquities and all of the wrong things that we do, but He still says, "I love you, got a plan, got a purpose for you." So this song is really just about, I love the chorus where it says, "Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, how we need you now." And especially with what's going on right now, just in life, sometimes, you know, we have things that come into our space, into our mind and thoughts in our life, things that we can't control, but God is the same today as He was yesterday and as He will be forever. So as we get into this next song, let's just make this our heart cry, our declaration that God, we need you. God, we're calling on the name of Jesus. We're calling on the God of Jacob, the God of David, that made a shepherd boy courageous. So God, as we sing this next song, God, this is our heart today, God, that we want more of you. We need you, Jesus. We need healing if we need it, God. You are the God of miracles. And so God, we just thank you for all that you're doing in this place today. And we're calling on that name of Jesus this morning. I'm calling on the through his love, whose love endures through generations. Sing, I know. same God. You freed the captives, then you're freeing hearts right now. You are the same. Call out your voice, you're the same. You are the same. So you touch the lepers. You touch the lepers, then I feel your touch right now. You are the same. You're all the same. You are the same. I'm calling on the Holy Spirit. Come on. Almighty River, come and fill me again. Come and fill me again. Come on, sing it out. Come and fill. Oh, come and fill me again. Amen. God, we just thank you for this morning. Guys, we just sang, God, we need you. We always need you, God. We are nothing without you, God. And so, God, let that be our prayer in our heart this morning, is God, that we want more of you. We need you, Jesus. We need your Holy Spirit. We're calling on the Holy Spirit. God, we thank you for your presence this morning. We thank you that you are the God today that you were yesterday and that you'll be forever. That, God, we can put our hope and our trust in you, Jesus. That, God, with you all things are possible. So, God, I just ask that you open our heart. God, that you would tear down any distractions, any walls that we would be putting up or that we have up, God, to receive what it is that you have for us this morning. God, again, we thank you that you breathe miracles when we need it. That, God, you are our healer. And, God, we just thank you that you provide for us too. And so, God, we just give you all the praise, give you all of our worship this morning in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people said, amen. Come on, God is good. Amen.
Amen. As you're seated, look at somebody and say, man, you look sharp today. Just encourage, man, you look sharp today. Do you know why we need to hear that? You know why? Because it's still raining in June. Where is summer? I mean, it poured this morning. I'm like, oh God, help us. Anyway, you do look sharp this morning. And for some of you that may be newer to church, isn't the presence of God good? Some of you might be there and, like, you know, maybe you felt something or maybe a tear welled up. It's the presence of God. And God, the Bible says God inhabits, which means God is there. God inhabits the praises of his people. When we praise God, the presence of God comes. And that's the beauty of being in church. That's the beauty of coming and worshiping as a family of God. And so this morning, we're going to keep worshiping with our tithe and our offering. And I always love to say the CLC is, thank you for being a generous church. Thank you. We live to give. God has blessed our church as we have been a generous church. We support over 60 missionaries and missions projects. We help with benevolence. We help, you know, with disaster relief. We gave over, what, $10,000 early on to the Ukrainian humanitarian relief efforts. You're sitting in a very generous church because enough people in our church have understood when we keep God first, God will take care of us. And I'm not just saying that. I really am not just saying that. If you don't tithe, I beg you, start tithing. Not because the church needs your money, but because you need the blessing of God. If you were here this morning and you didn't plan to give anything in the offering, I challenge you, give. Give anything in the offering. I promise you, God will bless you. And everybody who tithes in this church would say amen, right? Amen. God really blesses the giver. But here's the preface of giving. God blesses a cheerful giver. You got to have a smile on your face. Not like you just sucked on 10 pounds of lemons. God loves a cheerful giver. So you give with a good heart, thanksgiving, and I promise you, God will bless you. Ushers, would you come forward this morning? We're going to receive our regular tithe and offering. You can see different ways to give. And again, I encourage you to give today. Again, tithe is where we start, then missions giving and benevolence and all in and those initiatives. But let's pray. God, thank you for your blessings on us. And God, we always pray here at CLC that we are so incredibly thankful and grateful for the jobs that we have, the income that you provide. Lord, I pray that you would bless all the businesses and business owners in our church, God, that as we keep you first, Lord, we know that you bless and you're faithful, God. So Lord, we also pray for all of our missionaries and missions partners around the world and all of our local community partners, that you would bless them as well, provide in this season of increasing need. And Lord, may the church always rise up and be that place that meets people's needs where they are. So Father, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you as you give.
Hey, CLC Online, Pastor Virgil here. And I just want to say it is such an honor to have you joining us online week in and week out. I know there's people that watch out of state, out of country, and it's an honor to have you worship with us. And then during this time of giving, I'm also encouraged by just the sheer number of you who give online, support our All In initiative, support missions, giving. All of that is so important as we collectively come together and give. So I just wanted to jump in here in the middle of service and honor you and thank you for being a part of our mission as a church. And if you're kind of scrolling through social media, you're scrolling through online media, maybe you're on YouTube and you found us, it's an honor to have you worshiping with us. I'm sure that you were encouraged by the singing and the worship and just the alive feeling of being at church. And then also for those of you who join us for the message. It's an honor and we love you, CLC Online. God bless you.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. This service actually says it back. Third service does not. Thus, you are my favorite service. But good morning. If I haven't yet met you, my name is William. I'm our youth pastor here at CLC. I want to say thank you again for being here. But I did want to invite you out to Compassion Week this year. It is in just 2 weeks. It is an event we started last year. It was so good last year that we shifted the schedule around a little bit, changed some different things so that more of our entire church can be a part of it, not just our youth ministry. And so essentially what the week is, during the day we're doing different service projects with the county and the city and all kinds of different things in our community. And then every night we're having incredible conference services each and every night. And don't worry, it won't be too loud this year. We are definitely toning it down so it can be more of an all-church event. And as you saw, the speaker lineup this year is incredible. Pastor Dobie Weasel is preaching. John Weasel is also preaching. I talked to him this week, and I said we're calling it Weasel Weekend. So they're both preaching. You don't want to miss it. We've got guest worship coming in. Absolutely incredible. So it's Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday night. But on Saturday, the thing that I am most excited about this year is, as a church, one of our values is evangelism. As you walk in the church, you'll see our seven core values. And our value number two is evangelism. And one of the things we're doing this year is on the Saturday, we're actually sending teams to three parks in Port Orchard. And we're going to be doing a full-on kids outreach that Saturday at each of the parks. We're doing face painting and human videos and all these different things that kids are going to do skits and share testimonies. And we're going to do the whole nine yards, do outreaches at each of these parks on Saturday, canvas the neighborhoods. I mean, we're doing the full thing. And so we would love for you to be involved this year in any way, shape, or form. If you'd like to be involved, maybe even help and serve students lunch during the day, whatever it is. If you're interested in helping or attending, text the word compassion to 98366. And if you're interested in registering your student for all of the activities, you'll have the prompt there as well. Text compassion to 98366, and you can sign up to either volunteer or register your student. And it's going to be an incredible 3 days you cannot miss coming up here in just a few weeks. But today, we're continuing our series, Watch Your Attitude. Now, will you just look at the person next to you? You don't even need to say the full watch your attitude. Just look at them. Just say, watch it. Just let them know. Just say, watch it. You're not doing it. I can see some of you not doing it. I can see you. just say, watch it. Look at them. Look at them. Say, watch your attitude. Some of you are a little scared to talk to your spouse. You're like, no, I'm not saying that one, buddy. Anyways, but it's been an incredible series. How many of you guys have learned something so far? Anyone? I've definitely learned something. This past few weeks have just been so good. And so today we're continuing through our series looking at Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, the most important section, which many consider really the culmination of Jesus' teachings, which are the Beatitudes, which are where Jesus says, blessed are the blank, blessed are the, and he gives a full outline of what it means to be blessed, who are the people that are blessed, and what that looks like. And so today we're continuing, and we're in Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. It says this: blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are the peacemakers. If you've got notes, circle that word, peacemakers. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Let's pray together this morning as we get it ready to get into the word. God, we just thank you so much for the way that you love us and care for us. God, I pray that today that it would be your Holy Spirit that opens up our hearts. We know you're already here. We've already felt your presence in worship. You're here speaking to us. So God, I pray that it would be your words today. God, you would speak through me. It would not be my ideas, my thoughts, but what it is that you have for us, God. And I pray that each and every person would realize you brought them here for a reason. And your Holy Spirit right now, God, will just bring to the surface the things you're going to deal with today, the encouragement, the challenge you're going to give us. So Father, we love you. In the name of Jesus, everyone says, amen. Amen. So we're talking about what it means to be a peacemaker today. I was talking to Pastor Virgil, and he says, yeah, be a peacemaker, not a troublemaker, right? And I don't know about you, but it kind of seems like a lot of times when we're in different situations, it's like, man, I wish I had peace here. I wish I had peace there. I wish I had peace there. But a lot of times, it's not our situations that necessarily are the problem, but a lot of times, we're the problem. You know, anybody agree with that one? So, but the funny thing is the way that the world teaches to have peace is this. It says either you need to get rid of something. There's something in your life you need to get rid of, and then you would eventually have peace. Or there's something you're missing, and if you have that thing in your life, then you would have peace. Sociologists actually call this positive peace and negative peace. There's a whole philosophy behind it. And that's the world's teaching behind peace. It's that simple, that if we would just get rid of these things, we would have world peace. And if we would just add these things to society, we would have world peace. And that's the whole concept. But the truth is, we can't just simply do that and have world peace. The truth is that peace comes from who we are as people. And just recently, Adriana and I welcomed a new animal into our household. We recently got a new golden retriever. He's 2 years old. His name's Max. He's about 75 pounds. Our previous dog, Timmy, who's still with us, he's 9 pounds. And then we have a 10-pound cat. So we're kind of like all right there. And so it's really fun watching them interact and stuff. And if you've ever owned or had a working dog, like a working breed, like a lab or a golden retriever or anything like that in your house, you know, they're like incredibly smart. Like it is ridiculous how smart this guy is. Like you could teach him anything. And he's so food driven. Like if you have a treat, he will learn anything from you. Like it's just crazy. And so when you have a 9-pound little terrier, like the motivation to train him is really not there, right? He's kind of like, he would sit in our lap, you know, he can sit, you know, that's kind of like the extent of my training with our first dog, Timmy. But now that we have this golden retriever, I'm like inspired, like, you know, like maybe I'll take up duck hunting. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just like, I got this dog, right? So we've been working on training him. And the funny is through this process, the thing that has really stood out to me is it's not so much that you train your dog. It's more so that like you train yourself. And then depending on how you act is how your dog acts. And it's just been this mind-blowing experience for me. That's like, if you want your dog to be calm and relaxed, you have to be calm and relaxed. And if you go up to a dog and you're like, oh my goodness, how are you? They're going to be crazy, right? They're going to go crazy. They're going to be rolling all over the place. But if you're calm and collected, the dog will be calm and collected. And so if we want peace in our house now with three animals that like to go crazy constantly, we've learned like, hey, I got to be peaceful. If I walk in calm and collected, it's okay. But if we walk through the door excited to be home, oh my gosh, everyone, it's just chaos for like 15 minutes, right? And really the truth of the matter is peace is something that comes from us being people that have peace and carry peace with us. And the same way, and I'm saying in our household, the way that works in society, the way it works everywhere is we have to be people that have peace, then we walk into situations that have peace. And the way you can even tell this is you're like, man, it just seems like chaos at work. It just seems like chaos at home. It just seems like chaos in my family. It just seems like chaos here. Well, the only common denominator between all of those things is you, right? So many times you have to realize maybe I need to work on being a person that has more peace in my life. And the truth is the only way that you and I can truthfully experience peace is through the person Jesus Christ. Look at what it says in John 14, 27. It says this. This is Jesus speaking. It says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled and do not be afraid." That Jesus says the world has this idea of peace and it doesn't really work. Can I get an amen? But instead, he says, I have a different kind of peace that actually works. That what I give you is different than anything anyone else could possibly offer. And the reason for this is because the book of Isaiah says this, that Jesus said he is the Prince of Peace. That Jesus, it is in his character. It is his identity. It is who he is peace. Jesus doesn't say, I can change some things in your life and maybe give you a more peaceful reality. He doesn't say that. He says, I am peace, and a relationship with me will bring peace into your life. So you will never truthfully have peace in your life unless you know Jesus. Super old school preachers would say it this way. I'm going to say it because it's cheesy and it works. Is this? You have to read on the screen to really get what I'm saying. It's to know Jesus, it's no peace, but know Jesus is no peace. I said it. It's cheesy. Like everything inside of me didn't want to say that cheesy phrase, but it works, right? To K-N, know Jesus is to know peace. But if you don't have Jesus, you don't have peace, and that's just plain and simple. That you and I, the core basis of our lives is to know Jesus, and complete peace cannot happen unless you know Jesus. And this happens in one of two ways. And the first way is that just through Jesus' presence, there's peace. Like today, when we were worshiping, for those of you that are online, you missed out. I mean, when we were seeing Jesus paid it all, there was something in the room, right? That we're saying, wow, God, you're here. There's just like that moment where you're in church, when you're with other believers, when you're worshiping and the Spirit of God is there, there's just this overwhelming peace. The Bible describes that as the peace that surpasses all understanding. That there's just this moment of like, when you're in Jesus' presence, there's peace. And the beautiful thing is we all get to experience that, but the problem is your walk with God cannot stop there. Because the truth is, we can't all stay here forever. We have to go home. We have jobs, right? We have tasks. We have homes. We have things we have to do. We have to go out in the world. And you can't just be like, oh, I'm dealing with an unpeaceful situation. Let me call Brandon Couch and get him to sing, and we'll worship something. No, you can't do that. That's unrealistic. And so Jesus always does two things. Not only does he supernaturally work in our lives and free us of things, deliver us from things, work in our lives, he also teaches. And says, hey, I'm willing to free you from this, give you supernatural peace, but I'm going to teach you how to maintain it, how to walk this out in your life each and every day, how to maintain it. And so today, as we're walking through this, we're learning not just that Jesus can give us peace, but he also wants us to maintain it. So we're going to look at three of the things that the Bible teaches are peace killers. That you and I have to watch out for these things. That Jesus says, I'm going to give you this peace, but if you want to maintain it, you have to watch out for these three peace killers. Number one is this. We lack peace because we keep looking at our missing pieces. We lack peace because we keep looking at our missing pieces. Look at Philippians 4, 11 through 13. It says this. I am not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content. Everybody say content. Whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content. Say it one more time. Content. In any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want, I can do all things through him who gives me strength. And this really reminded me of this last few months ago in the spring. We got to go on a mission trip with our team. Some of you were here in this room that went on the trip with us. It was a really awesome experience. And one of the days, we got to work with kids at this daycare. And so we're there, and we had stopped at Walmart on our way over and purchased all these different crayons and chalk and all this different stuff we were going to do with them. And so we went out, and we were playing with all these kids, and the funny thing is when you're there, you know, when you're on a missions trip, as soon as like a couple kids learn that you speak Spanish, they're like glued to you, like, finally we can communicate with one, right? So we're there, and Adrienne and I are walking, and on our way there, we had bought these like variety packs of puzzles. They're like these 24-piece puzzles, and it came with like 8 or 12 puzzles in this pack thing, right? It was only like $3. It was really responsible. Okay, so we were like, okay. So we get there, and these two little girls come up to Adrienne and I and like pull us to the ground. Like, you will play with us, right? So they sit us down, and I'm like, okay, we'll put a puzzle together, right? 6 puzzles later, we're still putting puzzles together, right? And we're going, and we're doing this, and we're doing this. And then all of a sudden, we get to one of the puzzles. It was Frozen, and we were missing part of Elsa's face. And I'm like, hey, we can't finish it. We're missing a puzzle piece. And where we were at was just on this big cement area, like underneath a gazebo. And there was like a bunch of toys and different things that have all gotten mixed up. And I said, hey, we're missing a piece. And these two little girls like went on the search. They're looking everywhere, turning every toy over, every puzzle piece they could find. They were literally like, they just boom, darted. I'm going to find it. And they find this puzzle piece, and they come back, and they complete the puzzle, and they're like super duper excited. But like the moment they realized they were missing something, they went searching for it. And the truth is, in our lives, we do the same thing. The moment somebody tells us we're missing something, what do? Oh, I'm missing something? You're telling me my life's not complete? That I need something? I need to go get it. You're telling me if my house had more square footage, I would be happier? I need a new house. We got to get on Zillow. We need to start looking at Redfin. We need to keep our eyes out, get pre-qualified for a house because we need a bigger house. And all of a sudden, people tell us we need something. And all of a sudden, we're on the search. Oh, I need this. I need that. I need this. Our peace is out the window. When all of a sudden someone else tells you what you need, you begin to search. And we live in a society that is constantly telling us what we need. You need more of this. You need more of that. You need this kind of vacation. You need these kinds of kids. You need this kind of education, this kind of career. And if you don't have those, then there's something wrong with you. And none of us like feeling like there's something wrong with us. So when society tells us this, all of a sudden we're on the search. We're on the run. We're looking everywhere other than at God, who has already blessed us with something amazing. And look at what he said. He said, the secret is to be content. He says, I know what it is to have a lot, and I know what it is to have a little. Neither of those are the key. The key is to be content. And the word content, you know what the word content means? It means to have enough. To say, I'm good. I have had enough. I'm content with the amount I have. How countercultural is that? To say, I have enough. Like, have you ever heard somebody say, I have enough money? Like, no, right? You rarely in our society ever say, I'm fine, I'm good, I've had enough. We're the opposite. Our culture says, well, if a little is good, then more must be better, right? And we need to learn how to be, say, God, I'm not going to strive for the things I'm missing because that's just going to steal my peace, but instead I'm going to learn to say, I'm good, I've got enough. And recently I met a man that really exemplified for this and it really inspired me. I was talking to one of our ushers recently and that happens to be a painter. They own their own business painting. And every time I talked to him, I was like, oh, what projects are you working on? What are you doing this? What are you doing that? And he's a one-man show, just does his own thing. He doesn't have a big crew or anything. And I always ask him, like, oh, you know, if you had guys that worked for you, you could do this, you could do that, you could have more business, you could have all this. And he was like, yeah, I'm not doing that. He's like, I've done that in the past. That's not my priority. And he straight up told me my priorities are my kids and ministry. And that's my priority. And so work is just secondary. Just, you know, I do what I do to have enough. And I'm good. My focus are my kids and ministry. He's like, I could work more. I could make way more money. I could have a crew. I could be running all these jobs. He's like, but I'd be stressed out. And I would not be making my kids and ministry a priority. And I want to be at church for Celebrate Recovery. I want to be here to do these things. And so I'm making that a priority. And I don't work as I work. And so I'm good enough. And I thought, wow, how much does that exemplify this scripture right here? To say, yeah, I'm good. I've got enough. My life is good, happy, things are great. God, thank you for what you've given us. And the truth is we need to stop searching for those missing pieces to our puzzle and learn to be content and say thank you to God for the things he has given us. In Philippians 4:6, it says this. You don't have it in your notes. It says this. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Because a lot of times when you say, man, I've got this problem coming on. Have you ever heard somebody just like cheesily tell you, well, just pray and just give it to God? Right? Have you ever had that? Sometimes that advice doesn't sound very good. You know what I'm saying? It's like, that's really your answer right now, is to just pray? And sometimes we try it. We say, okay, well, I have all these problems, so I'm just going to complain all of my problems to God and see if I feel better. And the truth is, the answer is to pray. The answer is to give it to God. But we have to analyze how we're praying and how we're giving it to God. Because Paul right here did not say, sit and gripe to God about everything you need and he'll make you feel better. It doesn't say that. But that's what we do. We say, I'm going to sit down and complain to God and ask him for a million things. And then we get done and we don't feel any better. It's like, man, I still have any peace in my life. But instead, look at what it says. He says, when you pray, pray with thanksgiving. To say, I've got these problems, but I'm not just going to sit here and gripe to you, God. I'm going to say, thank you. Thank you for this you've given me. Thank you for that you've given me. Thank you for this you've given me. That in order to combat the chaos in your life, if you want to have peace in your life, it's about praying and saying, God, I thank you for this. Make it a part of your morning prayer every morning. Adrienne and I do this every single morning. We wake up and we just say thank you for everything we can think of. I say, God, I thank you for my house. God, I thank you for my car. I thank you for my truck. God, I thank you for my wife. I thank you for our marriage. I thank you for my dog. I thank you for this cup of coffee. I think, like, literally just every little thing you can say thank you for. All of a sudden, your whole mentality changes. And you begin to say, wow, I don't need those missing pieces. God, look at all you have given me. And one of the ways you'll begin to realize if you're working on this is a situation of your life you need to do, is it says you become a peacemaker. If that means you take peace with you places. But when you don't have this practice in place, everywhere you go, you point out the things other people need. Look at you need this. Look at you need that. Look at you need this. Look at you need that. Your area of lack is now making you point out the other people's area of lack. But instead, if you become a person that you're saying, I am full of peace, I am full of gratitude, people love to be around you because you're positive. Man, oh man, God's so good, isn't it? Look, it's raining today, but I got an umbrella, praise God. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's this thing of saying, wow, I have peace in my life, so I can be a peacemaker in every situation that I'm in. So not only do we need to stop looking at our missing pieces, but number two, we don't have peace because we keep looking at our problems. Hebrews 12, 1 through 2 says this, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. And so I love what this means. And what it's saying is when you say, I want to follow Jesus, I want to be a Christian, I want to do what God has for my life, you set out on a new journey with a new heading. Your true north now is Jesus. He is the focus. He is the pioneer, the perfecter of your faith. I say, I am focusing in on you, Jesus. And if anyone has ever told you being a Christian is easy, they are filthy liars, okay? Because the moment you say, Jesus, I'm following after you, I'm going to chase after this, the enemy is like, no, you're not. I'm going to do everything I can to make you, help you not do that. And the thing that he will try and attack you in is in your area of endurance and perseverance, is to say, I can get this guy to quit. And the enemy has been really successful in getting people to quit things lately. To say, oh, I can get this guy to quit. I can get them to quit what it is they're doing. We just did a whole series on quitting. And that's what it's saying here, is to have peace in your life, you have to begin to realize, how do I have laser focus on what Jesus has for me, who he is, and not get distracted and be starting to look at the problems that all of a sudden can become huge in my life. And this is the one of the main issues we're facing as a society, is we all have a really keen idea of the problems we're facing. And especially as science and psychology and all these things advance, we learn more about ourselves as human. We know more about our society than we ever have, right? We know more about conditions. We know more about syndromes. We know more about all of these things. But instead of using these as tools to say, okay, I'm dealing with some stuff, now I'm going to move past it. Instead, what has happened is we've created labels for people. And then all of a sudden, that's your label, so therefore you can't continue. You're dealing with this, and so that's who you are, and that's what you're going to be the rest of your life because you're dealing with this. And so you should just quit on what's going to happen. And the thing is, it's become, it's called a stigmatization, this thing of saying that now that you have been given this thing, there's a stigma with it. And so now all of a sudden you're like, I'm good. I'm just going to quit. There's no reason for me to go. I have this syndrome. I have this thing. I'm quitting. I'm done. And I work with a whole generation of students that have this attitude sometimes of just like, yeah, I'm done. I'm quitting. Look at the teen suicide rates in our country. Of kids are just realizing like, yeah, I'm quitting. It's not worth keeping up anymore. I've got this problem, that problem, this problem. It's not worth. I was talking to a student last week. We were at the waterfront walking out. I was having a one-on-one with a student. And this lady comes up who was 72. And she says, hey, can you take a picture for us? We say, yeah. She goes, it's a picture with me and my mom. I said, wait, you're 72 and you want to take a picture with you and your mom. Internally, I said that. I didn't say that to her. That would be rude. Okay. And so we walked up, and she goes, yeah, this is my mom. She's 96 years old. And she's standing there, and we took a picture with them. And I told the student, I said, 96. I said, you're like 15. I said, look at how much life you have ahead of you. I said, it's way too early to quit, man. It's way, like, you're going to quit at 15, at 16? And that's what the world is telling students. Hey, you're broken. There's something messed up with you. You can't keep going. And it's not that we need to avoid all those things. Like if you have things you're working through, if there's stuff you have issues going through, that's okay. But what we need to say is, I have a problem, but the problem's not bigger than God. That God is bigger than my problem, and I'm not quitting. And I am going to persevere, and I'm going to say, my problems are not big enough to take my peace. They're not big enough to derail me, but instead, I'm going to stay focused and have perseverance and not focus on my problems, but instead focus on the promise that God has for me. Look at Romans 8:11. It says this. It says, and if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of the spirit who lives in you. You may be saying, but you don't understand how big my problems are. But my answer to that is I do understand how big your problems are. I think the Bible is full of people that definitely realized how big their problems were. They even give measurements for their problems. David knew exactly how tall Goliath was. He was well acquainted with the problem in front of him. He just knew God was bigger. And in our lives, we need to say, I know that the world looks grim right now, but instead, I'm going to keep my eyes on the fact that God has a promise for my life, and he is bigger than anything that can face me. And we need to begin to say, God, I'm okay. I'm ready to focus in on the promise that you have for me. But the truth is, the enemy will do everything he can to keep your eyes off the promise God has for you. And it can even be in the smallest of ways. You know, this is something Adrienne and I have to work on all the time. We're always trying to keep each other accountable in this. Many of you know that Adrienne and I, scientifically, I guess, the doctor said we can't have kids. That's kind of the realm of life we live in. But I know for a fact that God has promised me that he's going to bless us with kids. A couple years ago, we were in Costa Rica when we were living there. I guess it was like 5 years ago now. We were living in Costa Rica. And at the time, we're in this worship service, and I just so clearly remember God speaking to me, saying, you're going to have a son, and he's going to worship me. And I thought, all right, God, I'm holding on to that. I didn't realize it would be this many years, but I'm saying, okay, God, I know you have a plan for my life. I know you have a promise for my life, and I'm going to focus in on the promise. But the problem is the enemy knows this is a sensitive area of my life, and so he always throws stuff at you. And it's hard to be like a youth pastor and a kids pastor. I'm the youth pastor. My wife's a kids pastor. And not have people constantly ask you, why don't you have kids? Like, don't you think it's kind of weird you're a kids pastor and don't have kids? You're like, yeah, I know. Been trying to work on that one, you know? Thanks for the reminder, you know? I'm just kidding. If you don't know, we're not offended whatsoever. I'm sorry. If you've ever said that, it's not, no problem. Right? But there's, I'm not bitter. just kidding. I'll erase your name out of my book. It's okay. But I have to guard my heart. I really have to guard my heart and say, I'm not looking at this problem. God, you have a promise for me. I'm not looking at this problem. God, I'm just ready for the amazing miracle you have in my life. God, I'm just ready. God, if you could open, like as we sang today, God, you're the same God. You did it for so many people in the Bible. And people even in our church have had the same testimony as us and have seen miracles work in us. And I say, okay, God, I'm keeping my eyes on the promise. And I don't know what that is for you. I don't know what that promise is you need to hold on to. But don't let Satan make your problems bigger than your promise and take away your peace. But instead say, I'm going to hold on to the promise of God. And so lastly, number three, We don't have peace because we keep looking at our past. We keep looking at our past. Philippians 3, 12 through 14 says this. Again, this is the Apostle Paul writing this from prison, says this. Not that I have already obtained this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Forgetting what is behind, striving for what is ahead, that he says, I'm going to begin to look and see what God has for me. It reminds me of an instance when I was about 19 and my friend and I were on our way to a conference in LA. I'm originally from California. And if any of you have, ever, I know a lot of you are from California, have lived in California. There's these things that are called freeways. Big ones, like real ones that have like eight lanes, right? You know what I'm saying? Like real, I was just there a couple weeks ago and I forgot, like, I just realized, man, Washington needs to up their interstate system. But anyways, right? So there's like eight lanes and there's a thing called a fast lane, which is all the way to the left. For those of you who weren't aware. Then next to that's the carpool lane, okay? And in California, the laws are a little bit different when it refers to the carpool lane. In Washington, we're all free willy. You can go in and out of carpool whenever you want. You can get in and out of carpool whenever you want. In California, not the case. There's entrances and exits to carpool. They're every couple miles, and you have to enter or exit only in these places. A lot of people break these rules, so they've actually put cones up in a lot of places. But you have to enter and exit only right there. And so my friend and I are in the carpool lane. I think we're on the 405. We're heading down to this conference. And he realizes, oh, our exit's coming up. I need to get out of carpool. Here's the carpool exit. So what he does, he puts his blinker on. Actually, he didn't. It's California. You don't use your blinker. But he begins looking over his shoulder, and he's looking in the side view mirror to the lane behind him to see when he can merge. You know what I'm saying? And so we're not going too fast. We're maybe going like 70 at this point. And he's looking over, and he looks in the rearview mirror, and he's looking. And we're in the carpool lane, and right next to our car is the barrier, you know, like one of those cement barriers. And we're driving, and he's looking in the side view mirror. And I'm assuming that he's a good driver and is going back and forth, looking forward, looking to the side, looking forward, looking to the side. But he's not. His eyes are just glued to that mirror, right? Like, I'm going to get over. I'm going to get over. Let me over. Let me over. Going to get me over. And I'm looking ahead, and our lane has stopped. And I'm like, hey, Ryan. Hey, Ryan. Hey, Ryan. He's like, no, I'm gonna make it, bro. I'm going to make it. I'm like, no, we're getting close. And so finally I smack him like, bro, we're going to hit this car. I smack him and there's just enough space between the car in front of us and the barrier for his little Hyundai to fit. It was, and we scrape the whole side of his car along the barrier and barely make it alongside the other car. Luckily, we didn't hit the car in front of us, but we immediately exit extremely shaken up and scared out of our lives, right? You know what I'm saying? And he was especially distraught because we were driving his dad's car, right? So it was just like bad situation. And so really the moral of the story is he was so glued to his side mirror to see what was happening behind him that he was missing what was happening right in front of him. And so many times, this is the way we live our lives, is I'm just so glued to the rear view mirror to see what happened in 2020, to see what happened here, to see what happened then, that we're so glued to that we're not seeing the vision God has for us in front of us. And Paul says, forget the past. You don't need rearview mirrors. Be like Mater, right? Like, you don't need them. Just drive forward. Just kidding. He has rearview mirrors. It's reverse. But anyways, say, look forward. Don't look behind. And so many of us are stuck in the past. And this is the truth of the matter. The past, most likely, was not as bad as you remember or as good as you remember. Like, people, for some reason, think that, like, 2019 and behind was, like, the greatest years of our lives. Like, oh, but before the pandemic, oh, man, things were amazing. It's like, I really don't think they were that much better. But we've made this, like, unrealistic fantasization of, like, the past. Of, like, it was so good. It was great. I really don't think it was that great. Then there's times, oh, man, do you remember how bad it was? Was it really that bad? You made it. You're alive. And we need to begin to say, okay, I'm not going to exaggerate what happened in the past. Now, some of us have dealt with deep trauma in your past and something that needs to be addressed. But for majority of the population, We need to begin to say, I'm going to forget that. I'm going to move forward. God has something for my future, and I'm not going to let the past steal my peace. And so for you, I don't know which of these three camps you fall in. Do you need to get your eyes off of the missing pieces? Do you need to get your eyes off of your problems? Or maybe you just need to get your eyes off of your past. Whatever it is, if you want to be a peacemaker where you take peace with you, you're not making trouble, you're making peace, you need to begin to say, I'm going to be a person of peace, and I'm going to keep my eyes set upon Jesus, the perfecter of my faith. Would you pray with me as we get ready to close? God, I pray for each and every person that's here. God, I pray for those in this room that have just been dealing with anxiety, have been dealing with worry, they've been stressed out. I pray that today, God, that you would speak to them and show them that not only can you supernaturally right now move in their lives, that that heaviness can be lifted off of them as they pray to you, God, but that you've also given them practical steps to say, this is how I'm going to walk out my faith. This is how I'm going to walk out a peaceful life each and every day. That God, there's some people in this room that they've been striving for something everyone else tells them they need, but they don't need it. And I pray that right now in their hearts, they would acknowledge all of the blessings you've given them. That we would not be so quick to look for other things and ignore what it is you've blessed us with right in front of us. We live in one of the most amazing countries on this planet. And you have blessed us with so much. We are so spoiled, God. And we say thank you for everything you've given us. Thank you for our families. Thank you for our jobs. We're alive today and we say thank you. Thank you for our children. Thank you for everything. And as we say thank you, God, we take our eyes off of what this world is trying to offer us and we say, Jesus, you're what we need. And we say thank you. And for those in this room, God, that have been dealing with problems, I pray that you would help them to get their eyes off of the barriers that are in front of them, the distractions. God, there's some people in this room that this week have received some diagnoses. And this diagnosis has made them feel helpless. This diagnosis has made them feel like they have no future. And it's taken all of their peace. And they've given up. But today you're reminding them that their life's not over. That if they're alive and breathing, they have a future. That you have a plan for their life, no matter what the doctors say. That God, you have a plan for their life. And I pray that they would keep their eyes fixed on you and say, Father, I'm ready to do what you have for me. I'm ready to keep my eyes fixed straight ahead. And God, I pray for those in this room that are struggling with their past. The past in their marriage, their past addictions, their past mistakes. We just forget those today. And God, we know that you're offering us a new future. That we can't change the past, but you can change our future, Father. So I pray that everyone's new future, new path would start right now, God. Would start today. That each and every one of us would realize you have a plan for our life and a purpose for our life. That we would have peace about what it is you're about to do in this next season in our life, God. That we would hold on to the promises. And lastly, God, I just pray for each and every person that's in this room, those that need a promise, God, those that need a reminder of the things you promised them when they were 16, the things you promised them of just even a few weeks ago, and those right now, God, that you're giving a promise to heal their marriage, a promise to heal their household, a promise to heal that physical ailment they're dealing with, a promise for a better tomorrow, God. I pray that they would so clearly hear your voice that they would have something they can hold on to no matter what the enemy tries to throw at them. They have a promise that is bigger than their problems, God. So we thank you, Father, that your promises never fail, that you always come through on everything you ever promised us, God, that in the waiting we will stay faithful, we will persevere, and we will see it come to completion in our lives, God, as we keep our eyes on you. So I pray that each and every person in this room would have peace this week, that you would bless them and keep them. Lord, we love you and we praise you in the name of Jesus. Amen, amen, amen. Would you give it out for good? Would you give it up for how good God is today? Amen. He is good. Hey, as we get ready to dismiss again, I just encourage you, fill out a connection card. If there's something going on in your life that you need other people involved in, there's stuff you're working through, you want other people to be praying for you, if there's a promise God's given you, write it on your connection card. Drop it in one of the giving kiosks on your way out. We would love to be praying for you this week. Again, don't forget Compassion Week in just a couple weeks. You don't want to miss it. And lastly, really fun thing coming up. We still have some tickets left for our Mariners game coming up, and not this Thursday, but the next Thursday. So if you would like to come to the Mariners game with us, please find us at the connection booth. We do have extra tickets there for sale. We would love for you to be there. But would you stand up with me as we get ready to dismiss? Now, would you look at somebody next to you and just say, watch your attitude. Just let them know. Say, watch that attitude. Love you guys. See you next week.
Hey, thank you again for tuning in with us. If you'd like to follow up with today's message and take your life with Jesus to the next level, make sure to fill out an online connection card so we can connect with you and help you get plugged in with CLC. If you have a prayer request this week, our staff and prayer team would love to pray alongside you this week. We love you, CLC, and we can't wait to see you next week.
Suddenly all the shame is gone. I thought I was too broken, now I see. You were breaking new ground inside of me. Standing in your presence.